Hello everyone, and welcome to my playthrough of Vampire the Masquerade Bloodlines. This is a game which I have not played for a long time. I have played the game before. This is a game that holds quite a few good memories for me. Redemption was kind of like my entry point into the Vampire the Masquerade universe, even before I actually played the tabletop version. And this game, Bloodlines, is a game that a lot of people love. A lot of people, whenever you even talk about Vampire the Masquerade, they immediately think Bloodlines. This game is freaking awesome. And it's made by a company that no longer exists called Troika Games. I believe it's called Troika. And it's such a shame, because this game did not sell well when it first came out, and became a sleeper hit. Like, more than a sleeper hit, a cult hit, even after the company dissolved away, unfortunately. There have been a lot of fan mods after the game came out, even in the more recent years. And this game, this version that I'm going to be playing, has the basic patch, not the plus patch. So the basic patch basically fixes a lot of bugs, way too many to name, because this game is buggy as shit. It fixes a lot of the bugs, so the game is a more smooth experience. I did not install the plus because I've heard both good and bad things about it. Plus basically adds stuff that was taken away from the game. The developers like initially had, and like modders basically kind of like added on to it, but you know, the developers took away for whatever reason initially before the game even came out. So I kind of just wanted to play the game the way it was meant to be played, minus the bugs. So anyways, without further ado, let's go into a new game. So one thing I will say is, if you watch my playthrough of Redemption, Vampire the Masquerade Redemption, and you were still kind of fuzzy on a lot of the technical terms, like caitiff, coterie, kindred, that kind of shit, this game actually does a fairly decent job of explaining what all that stuff is. And this version is one that I'm more familiar with, even with the tabletop. And we'll kind of get into that. So, first off, so you can actually choose your clan in this game by actually just flat out doing like a quick, like making a quick character, taking a quiz, or manually making one. So, answer a series of questions about the type of vampire you like to play and allow the game to create your character, which is basically taking a quiz. Go directly to the character sheet and set your character's clan, gender, history, attributes, abilities, and disciplines yourself. Or spoilers, replay some Bloodlines missions as a human hunter from Society of Leopold. That's new. Well, we're not going to be doing that. I'm not going to be doing the quiz. You know what? Let's take the quiz. You can always change your mind afterwards. Let's see what the game will give me. Would you like your character to be male or female? I will go with a male. Some drunken mortals attempt to pick a fight with you in a bar. Do you trash the place with the fool's broken bodies, or clear the place out with a mere wave of your hand? I mean, come on. Second option. A bouncer at the opening of an exclusive nightclub won't let you inside to party with all the beautiful people. Do you convince him you work for the director, you know who, and you'll bring him with you next time? Hide out by the back exit, wait for someone to leave and then slip in undetected? Or bribe him? Everyone's got their price, and it's worth it to know the kind of people inside. I wouldn't go with the third option. I do kind of like both the charisma and the sneaking. I'll probably go with the charisma-based one. You were mugged last night. It wasn't life-threatening, but you want to take some measures to make sure that if it happens again, you aren't defenseless. Do Do you sign up for a martial arts class? Next time they try it, you'll break their spine. Start carrying a knife and conceal it in your belt. Next person who tries it breathes through a hole in their neck. Or buy a gun. The next mugger is sidewalk me. So this is basically asking, would you rather melee, like, you know, fisticuffs, have a weapon, like a melee weapon, or have a gun? I'll probably have a weapon. While in a club, you spot your ex-roommate who skipped out after taking your stuff and leaving you with a stack of bills. He looks dead drunk. Do you grab him by the head and repeatedly bash his face into the bar, or call the cops? See you in court, buddy. I mean, in the real world, you do this, but in the vampire world, I guess this kind of just shows how hot-headed you are. I'm going to go with the second option. Less bloody. You're outbidded at an auction for a macabre piece of art that you just must have. You know the collector who won it. You've even been to his house. Do you get a few drinks into him later and persuade him to sell it to you? Wait until he leaves, find a spare key and make it look like a robbery? Or write an unflattering critique on the artist, get it published, and just wait for your friend to try to unload it? Ooh, I do kind of like this third option. Yeah, you know what? I like this third option. Very underhanded. Your new neighbor is everything you've ever wanted in someone. How do you get them to go out with you? It's funny that it should say that. It doesn't matter. Spend a good amount of time around the windows topless. They'll come running in no time, or they'll probably be impressed by how hard you work. The flashy new car can't hurt either. How hard you work? How would they even notice? Okay, let's go with the first one. The world's a cruel and unforgiving place, but you've gotten by so far. Why? When you're as talented and as attractive as I am, the world is your plaything. Because I keep it a secret. You have no idea of the truths I've learned. I kind of like the second one. So you've been embraced by the Tremere clan. Tremere are the practitioners and creators of the blood magic called Thaumaturgy. Not generally trusted by other clans, Tremere are enshrouded in mystery and keep their motives hidden. Okay. Your vampire's attributes and abilities have now been determined and entered into its character sheet, which you will see next. After your tour of the character sheet, you may make changes to the character or simply play it as is. Okay. So these are attributes and abilities which feats are derived from. Attributes are your inherent character traits and are broken into three categories: physical, social, and mental. Abilities are things you learn and are also broken into three categories: talents, skills, and knowledges. So these are main attributes that govern a lot of your different abilities, and these are kind of like the more specific talents, skills, and knowledges. Okay. Members of the sinister Tremere clan are masters of vampiric sorcery. So your strongest attribute is mental, in which you have 2 points you can spend. You also have 1 point to spend in physical and no points in social, your weakest attribute. As for abilities, being Tremere gives you an advantage in your arcane knowledges. Therefore, you have 3 points to spend. You have only average abilities and talents and are weak in skills. Okay. Feats are the actions you perform in the game. Feats are derived from adding an attribute and an ability. An example would be the feat of lockpicking, which is derived from the attribute of dexterity and the ability of security. Hovering your mouse pointer over a feat will highlight the attribute and ability upon which it is dependent. If you guys don't get it, I'll show you in a minute what it means. You are a member of the Tremere clan, masters of blood sorcery. Tremere are feared and mistrusted by other vampires, for the rituals and spells of these warlocks are as potent, if not more so, than any other vampiric power. Their disciplines are auspex, are a perception, dominate, mind control, and thaumaturgy, blood magic. Cool. This is your humanity. 7 is the norm. 10 is saintly, and the lower you go to the close, and the lower you go, the closer to the beast you become. Also, the lower your humanity, the greater your chances of frenzy. When a vampire goes into a frenzy, he loses all control and attacks any and all things around him. We saw a lot of that as Christoph, didn't we? However, as you gain experience, you can expend experience points to increase your humanity. Okay. This is where your masquerade violations are displayed. The masquerade is a code by which many vampires unlive. Anytime a vampire is seen doing a supernatural act by a mortal, it is considered a masquerade violation. You have 5 chances, and each strike will have repercussions. If you commit 5 masquerade violations, you will be dealt with harshly. This is where all information on things you are hovering over is displayed. Okay. The auto level on-off button is a toggle that allows you to decide whether you want the computer to allocate your experience points you earn in the game among your attributes, abilities, and disciplines, or whether you wish to allocate them yourself. The reset stats button is another toggle that allows you to clear out your point allocation so that you can start over or return them to the last settings. The cancel button allows you to return to your last point in the game without changing your character sheet. Once you are satisfied with your character settings, click on the accept button to play the game. Okay. So, what all this stuff basically means. So, all the feats on the side here are basically part of 2 different stats. Attributes and abilities. So, attributes govern the more, like, general, while abilities are more specific. So let's say in research, it literally says here, when I highlight it, intelligence, I'm pointing at the screen. You could see intelligence and scholarship are both yellowed out. If I go inspection, it's perception and investigation. Let's see another one here. So what's a good one to do? Okay, so lockpicking is dexterity and security. But sneaking is dexterity and stealth. So the attributes, again, they're like the main ones, and abilities are like more specific to the different feats you can have. The attributes will generally cost more to upgrade, while the abilities will cost less. And disciplines are your vampiric powers. And it actually, thank God, it actually even tells you what the different levels do. So strength is basically strength. It's a measure of your character's physical prowess. It is crucial for both the unarmed and melee combat feats. Dex determines the speed and agility of your character. Dex will increase your lockpicking and sneaking feats. So it's good. It even tells you specifically what it does. Stamina. Your character's overall toughness prevents damage from bullets, police batons, and baseball bats. Increases soak bashing. Okay. So what that means, increases soak bashing, is if you guys remember from, if you guys watch my playthrough of Redemption, there's 3 different types of damages in this game. There's bashing, what's the second one? Bashing something and aggravated. Lethal. Bashing, lethal, and aggravated. So bashing is generally the weaker type of damage, so things like like bullets, police batons, and baseball bats, like more bludgeoning stuff is considered bashing. Things like swords and knives and daggers, that's more lethal. It basically does a little bit more damage to you, like overall it's harder for you to heal. Aggravated damage is the hardest to heal from, and it's generally it's more supernatural abilities that deal aggravated damage. Again, generally. So charisma measures your character's ability to sway others' through personality. Charisma is an important part of the persuasion feat. Manipulation is necessary for the haggle feat. Appearance is the foundation of the seduction feat. So perception is necessary for the range combat and inspection. Intelligence is essential for research and intimidate, and wits improves the defense and hacking feats. Okay. So before we go any forward, do we actually want to play as a Tremere? So let's cancel. Let's go back to a new game. So go directly to the sheet. So as I mentioned before, you get to choose your clan. You get quite a bit to choose from. So there's the Bruja. These aren't spaced properly. There's the Bruja or Bruja. It doesn't really matter. Gangrel, Malkavian, Nosferatu, Toreador, Tremere, and Ventru. So Bruja are the your typical vampire that you think of. Kind of like the... Actually, no, that's not entirely true. They're more your rebels. Think like... I guess the most akin thing I could think of is think of Blade. He would be a Bruja. Or Bruja. They're idealists and rebels. They're more of like the muscle guys. They're more of the soldiers, the grunts, that kind of stuff. They receive a plus one. Okay, so let's... I know I'm taking a long time going through this, but it's kind of important that you guys get to know this stuff. So they're passionate idealists and rebels, more likely to fight for their rights than write protest songs. In life, most Bruja sought social change, and in Undeath, most clan members commonly seek the creation of a vampiric utopia. As militant radicals, they are renowned for their combat skills, but are more likely to frenzy due to their hot-bloodedness, so to speak. They receive a plus one to their unarmed feat, but are penalized with a minus two to all frenzy checks due to their zealous natures. You cannot change the clothing, unfortunately. That is what your character will always look like. Let's just show the female, just because that's what the female looks like. So Gangrel are wild loners that are the most in tune with beasts within, allowing them to shapeshift into more beastly forms. Nomadic in nature, Gangrel care little about vampire politics and prefer to dwell and hunt in the outskirts of society. Because of their animalistic nature, they receive a plus five to strength, stamina, and wits during frenzy. However, because of their inherent feral nature, Gangrel receive a minus one on all frenzy checks. So, if you're more of like a D&D player, think of them more like druids. They're more, not necessarily in touch with nature, but they're more animalistic. Like even the guy, like, he's like fucking Beast from X-Men. So Malkavians are the crazy ones. Even looks crazy. The female one is just bizarre, man. Even the... Look at the bouncy boobs, man. Look at that shit. Jiggle effects are real. So, they're known as lunatics because their ability to hear voices of the insight and subject others to their insanity through their discipline, dementation. The world appears much different to the Malkavian than it does the same clans, though the extent of a Malkavian's madness depends on the individual. A blessing and a curse, a Malkavian's insanity will help or hinder them, depending on how much they struggle against their nature. Malkavians start with a plus two bonus to inspection. So, I should point out that if you have not, first off, if you have not played this game, you really should. Even if you are not a big fan of RPGs, even if you are not a big fan of like vampires or whatever, this game is awesome because the RPing is really, really good. The role playing in this game is really damn good. The story is really good. I really love a lot of the characters. Like, it's a cult classic for a reason. It's just that damn good. So, what I was saying was, yes, Malkavians play a certain way, okay? So I mentioned before, and it says here, that they are basically crazy. Your dialogue options will be insane. They actually spoil a lot of the story. If you're playing for the first time, you won't even understand what the hell it means. They speak in they speak not like coded messages, but what's the best way to describe it? What they're saying, you have to kind of figure out what they're talking about. Like, I don't know. You ever hear like a riddle? Like, oh my God, I'm completely blanking out. Think kind of like a Cockney. Someone speaking in Cockney, like rhyming slang, basically. Like if someone says like, "Oh, you got great mince pies." Like mince pies are eyes. That's what that means. Or you gotta put shoes on your plates of meat, which are feet. It's kind of like that. They speak in kind of like a, not a coded language, but in a way that only makes sense to them, and you have to decipher what they're saying, like what they truly mean. And they hear whispers. Like, again, you can answer dialogue in the game, even if it's your first time playing, that spoils the story of the game. Again, you won't really know what it's talking about. Regardless, I wouldn't recommend playing Malkavian as your first time. You totally can. Nothing's stopping you. But if you really want to enjoy the story and figure out what the hell's going on, I wouldn't play Malkavian at first. That's just me. Nosferatu. Look at that beauty. Hideous, skulking, and powerful. Even in a world of monsters, the Nosferatu stand out. The embrace twists and deforms their physical features, forcing them to seek sanctuary underground. Nosferatu are masters of the shadows. Due to their curse, Nosferatu have a seduction of zero and can never raise it higher, and they hide their existence from common humans. Having shared the darkness with vermin for so long, vampires of Clan Nosferatu are able to draw extra nourishment from rats. So, playing Nosferatu is another way where the game is played differently, because you cannot, if a human sees you, it's a violation of the masquerade right away. So you can't just like go walking around. You are basically stuck roaming around. Like, okay, I don't want to say you're stuck. You can't just walk around above ground. You have to use the sewer system to get from one place to another. In the beginning anyway. Later on, you can, if you upgrade your obfuscate, which is basically like your invisibility feat, or sorry, discipline, not feat, you can actually walk around invisible and not make any noise, basically. But again, I wouldn't recommend playing Nosferatu as your first time, because again, it's played differently. Again, nothing's stopping you. If you want to play Nosferatu, all the power to you. It's just a little bit more difficult. It's kind of playing hard mode. So Toreador is generally what I play. But before that, let me show you the male Nosferatu. Not that you can really tell the difference. I mean, I guess you can. But yeah. Toreador. This is what I normally play. They picture themselves as artists and visionaries, and they value the high society mentality that the Camarilla reinforces. Of all the clans, the Toreador are the most connected to the mortal world through arts and entertainment. Toreador are beautiful creatures, svelte and seductive, and move almost effortlessly through the society of the living. The Toreador's empathy is both a gift and a burden. All humanity's shifts are doubled. So what that means is if I lose humanity point, I lose two. If I gain a humanity point, I gain two. That's what that means. So the reason I generally play Toreador is because they're one of the more charismatic clans. I much prefer dialogue to action in my role playing. That's just generally me. So these guys again are high on like seduction, high on charisma, that kind of stuff. But so are the Venture, and we'll get to them. So Toreador, Tremere, these guys again are the blood mages, blood sorcerers born from mystic rituals and diablerie. The Tremere are the least trusted of the Camarilla clans. The ritual the Tremere used to transform from living mages to undying monsters stripped them of their magical arts. To compensate, the vampires of Clan Tremere developed thaumaturgy, the powerful discipline of blood magic. Clan guards its secrets jealously and are the only kindred to wield this powerful discipline. The pursuit of arcane knowledge comes before all else, and the reliance upon it has weakened the bloodline. Tremere can raise no physical attribute above 4 points. So, yeah, these guys, again, they're the blood mages. They were originally actual mortal mages that drew upon like the life energy of the world and the universe. But when they died and became vampires, well, when they stole, actually, the power from vampires, they lost that connection to the universe. And so they developed sorcery of the blood. That's how these guys work. And finally, Ventru. Truly the upper echelons of society, the Ventru are seen as the honorable and virtuous leaders of the Camarilla. They wholeheartedly support the Masquerade, influencing the mortal and undead worlds to help them maintain the Masquerade as well as garner support for themselves. Clan Ventru is an exclusive and powerful gathering of immortals, and even the lowliest initiate of Clan Ventru can expect special treatment in Kindred society. This regal bloodline, however, gains no nourishment from the lowborn and thin-blooded. Ventru gain no blood from feeding on animals. Feeding on low-life humans, prostitutes, and the homeless can cause the Ventru to vomit. This is one of the reasons why I normally don't play a Ventru. It's because they have very specific types of people that they can draw blood from. Like, when you create, like, a Ventru, you basically have to be specific. Like, let's say I'm building a character, I say I can only drink blood from redheaded females, or I can only drink blood from women with green eyes and tattoos, or people with green eyes and tattoos, like shit like that, you know what I mean? And if they drink blood from other things, they literally throw up. They gain no nourishment whatsoever. So they're a powerful clan, but to me, they're a little too restricting, especially when it comes to blood. And just to show the female, very ready for a night on the town. I like how the eyes move. So, I'm just going to go with what I'm generally comfortable with, the Toreador. I was kind of considering a Tremere. Just because, you do unlock... You could potentially, if you play your cards right, unlock a second Haven. Let's go with Toreador. That's okay. I'm gonna go as this. I don't know if he's a handsome guy, but yeah. Anyway, he looks so pretentious though, eh? Anyways, what should we name our guy? Let's name him. You know what? Let's go with the cringy Drake. Let's go with Drake. Why not? He looks like a Drake. Okay, so. Physical, we have no points of physical. We have 2 social stats to raise and 1 mental. So maybe we'll put 1 in charisma, part of the persuasion, haggle, and I guess we'll put 1 in seduction. So our seduction is 2 now. So what does persuasion generally do? Measure your character's ability to convince people that they want, that you do what they want to do. Haggle. Yeah. Perception, intelligence, or wits. Improve the defense and hacking feats. Research and intimidate. And range combat and inspection. Okay, I think we're good. Yeah, I like this. Although ranged, but I wasn't really planning on getting it. Whatever. It's fine. It's okay. All right, let's start it off. Half an hour into the video, we're finally starting the game. Oh, I forgot to turn on subtitles. Fuck. Oh no, I have it up there.
Thank you.
Oh, shit. Oh, fuck. Dead already. Well, pretty good game overall, right?
Good evening. My fellow kindred, my apologies for disrupting any business or interfering with prior engagements you may have had this evening. It's unfortunate that the affair that gathers us together tonight is a troubling one. We are here because the laws that bind our society, the laws that are the fabric of our existence, have been broken. As prince, I am within my rights to grant or deny the kindred of this city the privilege of siring. Many of you have come to me seeking permission, and I have endorsed some of these requests. However, the accused that sits before you tonight was not refused permission. Indeed, my permission was never sought at all. They were caught shortly after the embrace of this child. It pains me to announce the sentence, as up to tonight I considered the accused a loyal and upstanding member of our organization. But as some of you may know, the penalty for this transgression is death. Know that I am no more adjudicator than I am a servant to the law that governs us all. Let tonight's proceedings serve as a reminder to our community that we must adhere to the code that binds our society, lest we endanger all of our blood. Forgive me. Let the penalty commence.
Ooh. Wing cut.
Which leads to the fate of the ill-begotten progeny. Without a sire, most childer are doomed to walk the earth never knowing their place, their responsibility, and most importantly, the laws they must obey. Therefore, I have decided that...
This is bullshit!
If Mr. Rodriguez would let me finish... I have decided to let this kindred live. They shall be instructed in the ways of our kind and be granted the same rights. Let no one say I am unsympathetic to the plights and causes of this community. I thank you all for attending these proceedings, and I hope their significance is not lost. Good evening. Your sire. Tragic. My apologies. But you see, there is a strict code of conduct that all of us must adhere to if we wish to survive. When someone, anyone, breaks these laws, they undermine the well-worn fabric of our centuries-old society. Understand my predicament. Allowing you to live makes me directly responsible for your subsequent behavior. So... what I'm offering is not generosity, but the opportunity to transcend the fate woven by your sire. This is your trial. You will be brought to Santa Monica. There you will meet an agent by the name of Mercurio. He will provide the details of your labor. I've shown you great clemency. Prove it was more than a wasted gesture, fledgling. Don't come back until you do. Good evening.
So I bet a lot of you are like, what the fuck is going on? Sure. Item gained fists. Oh, I gained fists and hands. Very cool. So, one thing I will say. The game is meant to be like a what the fuck is going on in the beginning. You're not really meant to understand. Much like the character themselves, like himself... you're just thrust into this world with no real hand-holding. You know, the vampire that created you is killed in front of you. So she's not going to guide you. So I could explain everything, but we're just going to go with the flow.
Ha ha ha!
What a scene, man. Hoo-wee. Then they just plop you out here like a naked baby in the woods. How about that? Look, kiddo, it's probably a lot for you to take in, so why don't you let me show you the ropes? What do you say?
Who are you?
I'm Jack. What's important is I'm offering help. You make it back from Santa Monica with your hide and we'll trade life stories, okay? Till then, I got about this much time. You in or out?
Okay, so we got a bunch of options. I could use the help. I don't have much time. Just give me the basics. What happened in there? Or I don't need anyone's help. I'm out of here. Let's just say, okay, I could use the help.
All right. Why don't we, step out back here?
Yeah, let's get away from that horrible place.
Christ, it's stuffy in there, huh? This is much better. Now, we ain't got much time, but I figure somebody should fill you in on the bare bones stuff at least, you know? Could save your hide. You look wobbly. You even had a drink yet?
Drink of what?
Oh, man, we're popping a cherry here. Ha, ha, ha. Oh, you're gonna love this. All right, check it out. Blood, it's your new rack of lamb, your new champagne, blood, your new fucking heroin, kid. Get ready, though, because, hey, it's never as sweet as the first time.
What do I do?
Well, down around the corner there, I saw this human. Poor SOB can't find his car.
So, what do I...
Alright. You go down there, casual like. You creep up on him, then bear those little fangs and feed. Don't worry if you weren't captain of the wrestling team or something, because it'll come so naturally you think you've done it 1,000 times already.
Won't he become a vampire then? Or it's been one of those nights I can use a drink. Let's go with the first one.
Forget that comic book crap, kid. It don't work that way. Now go for it. Be sure, though, and this is important, so listen up. Be sure not to drain them dry, okay? It might be hard to resist, but don't kill them.
All right. So, this is your blood pool on the right. Blood is the fuel for your vampiric powers or disciplines. When your blood pool is low, you need to refill it. Humans are an abundant source of blood in most areas of the game. One is in the alley around the corner. Okay, so let's go take a look. Feeding on humans fills your blood pool. To feed, approach a victim and press the feed key. When you're close, it is important that humans do not see you feed on other humans. Once you have begun feeding on your victim, you will see this bar appear. This represents your victim's blood pool. You should stop feeding before emptying his blood pool and killing him. Press the F feed, press the feed again to stop beating.
What's wrong?
What's wrong? I'm thirsty is what's wrong. All right. And now they're blood. Well, not blood drunk. Lack of blood drunk.
See it in your eyes. You're a born-again predator. Feeling that blood bubbling inside you, lifting you up. That's it, kid. That's what it's all about right there.
Let's go with the second one.
All right, now. You got the blood. You're feeling all kick-ass. Feeling better than your best day living. But wait, it gets better. All kindred, that's a our word for vampire. All kindred have a few things in common. Things that set them right square above humans on the food chain.
Yeah, like what?
Like sharper senses, a body that can take a beating, and if you play your cards right, eternal life. That's no sure bet, but still, a chance at immortality is not a bad deal. And that's just for starters. Fringe benefits for joining the club.
So I'm gonna live forever?
Well, you can still be destroyed, but forget the books and the movies. Garlic, it's worthless. A cross? Shove it right up their ass. A stake? Only if it catches you in the heart, and then it just paralyzes you. Running water? That's no problem. I bathe. Occasionally. Now, a shotgun blast to the head. Oh, that's trouble, boy. Fire? That's real trouble. Sunlight? Well, you catch a sunrise and it's all over, kiddo. Get it?
Got it.
Okay, now. What the fuck is this? You get inside here and head upstairs. Meet up with me. I'm just gonna see what the fuck is this.
Now you do that. Oh, whoops. At the bottom of your screen is a use icon. This icon appears when you're able to use the object in front of you. Press the use key to use the object that it indicates. Use icon is context sensitive. That is, it will look different depending on the object you can use. In this case, a door that can be opened.
Go on, I'll meet you in there.
Okay. Press the jump key to jump. Jump on the box against the wall and up to the walkway. I forgot how floaty this game is. Ooh, lockpick. Your attributes, your feats are the combination of your various abilities and attributes. The higher your feat scores, the better you are at the activities they influence. Inspection is a feat. It is a combination of perception and investigation. It allows you to see hidden and secret things. For example, the lockpick on the crate in front of you. You can find your feats listed on the right-hand side of your character sheet. You can pick up certain objects in the world. If you are able to pick up an object, you will see a use icon appear for it when you are close enough, and the crosshairs in the center of your screen are over. Press the use key to pick up the lockpick. Sweet. Now you can lockpick doors.
Come down here. Stay away from the windows. Oh, it's a Sabbat raid. The Sabbat, they're, Christ, I was hoping to spare this shit till later. The Sabbat, well, they're mostly mindless, bloodthirsty assholes. That's all you need to know for now, all right?
So what's up?
The Sabbat got wind of the gathering here, so they figured they'd raise a little hell and put a little heat on the new prince.
What's the prince a prince of?
No time for political rundown. Job one, get out of here alive. Sabbat might be mindless, but they hit like a Mack truck, like raging savages. Nothing a fledgling like you wants to mess with.
So what am I supposed to do?
Shh, shh. Heads up. Back away. Sabbat bastards. All right, we gotta vamoose out the back quick. I'll stay and keep a watch out. You get us into the office. The door's around the corner here.
I'm on it. To access your quest log, press the quest log key. Default is out. Okay, good to know. Quest log contains information about your quests, as well as any notes and instructions you will need to complete them. When the door is locked, you will see this icon. Lockpicking, a combination of dex and security, is a feat that helps you open locked doors with a lockpick. When you see this icon, use the use key, press the use key and to try and lockpick it. Once you begin lockpicking, you will see this bar. It represents the time needed to pick the lock. If the value of your lockpicking feat is equal to or greater than the difficulty of the lock, you'll be able to pick it. Success! I opened the door, guys. Oh, hi, Jack.
shortcut. Well, nicely done, though. Not exactly.
Yeah, how'd he get in here?
In life, were you?
I had my moments.
Cool. Now, if you want a lesson on how really not to act, take notes from those Sabbat assholes. You're a big bad vampire. Yeah, great, congrats. Now keep it to yourself. You go roar and you beat your chest, and that's what you can expect.
Wait, I've just got a list of people from high school. Why not?
It's the same reason you don't let humans see you feeding. It's why the wolf doesn't want the sheep to know he's there. It's also why you don't go juggling dumpsters or outrun the 815 from Sacramento, and it's why you didn't know any of this when you woke up this morning.
Ah, I get it.
Keep our secret secret and you make things easier on all of us. We're living in the age of cell phone cameras. Fuck-ups ain't tolerated. Makes sense enough, right? Well, it ain't a casual thing for a fledgling like you.
What do you mean? What could happen?
That party back there with the guy in the suit and the Magilla Gorilla? The assholes that put your sire to death? That's the Camarilla. They make a tidy business out of enforcing vampire laws like this one.
So, Camarilla, they're like the vampire good guys?
Yeah, I'll tell you what I think some other time, maybe. I like to let people form their own opinions.
Alright, so what's next?
Alright, now don't worry, because I know the area a little, and you know what? I'm glad we're in this situation, you and I. It illustrates a point. You gotta utilize your surroundings.
Okay, but what does that mean exactly?
You do what you gotta do. Theft, destruction of property, breaking and entering. These will be the least of your sins before the night's out. So look around here. We gotta get out the back there through that magnetically sealed door. There must be a key someplace.
I'll find it. So, area indicator. Icon to the left indicates that you are in a combat area. Combat, anything goes. Masquerade, respect the masquerade. Elysium, vampire neutral ground. No combat or disciplines are allowed, except blood buff while lockpicking. In masquerade areas, breaking the masquerade can carry dire consequences, such as the unwanted attention of vampire hunters. After 5 masquerade violations, your game is over. Your current number of violations is displayed on the upper right corner of your character sheet. Cool. Die, my darling. It's like old school Evanescence. What is that? Password is Chop Shop. Well, good to know. When you can use a computer, you will see this use icon. Computers are often helpful in solving quests. They can hold information like emails and files, as well as control various electronic devices. Each computer will have a list of the menus and commands you can use. Many menus and commands will be password protected. Hacking, a combination of wits and computer, is a feat that allows you to hack into password protected items. You'll be prompted to press Control C to attempt your hacking feat. If the value of your hacking feat is equal to or greater than the difficulty of the encryption, you will be successful. To stop using a type, computer type, quit or use the escape key. Okay, so Brothers Downtown Garage. So we want safe. What did it say? Chop Shop. Okay. And then we want to unlock. Safe doors are unlocked. When you approach a container, you'll see this. Okay, yeah, we get it. And I immediately pressed the wrong button. Chop Shop key. Key to the stairwell at the back of the Chop Shop. Beautiful.
There you go. Now take that key card and head out the back. I'll meet you out in the alley there. I'm gonna check out things from topside.
Got it. Inventory key I. Some doors have magnetic locks that cannot be picked open. They must be opened with the appropriate key card. Yep, that's fine. Shit, Jack. Look at Jack go. You've been wounded by the Sabbat. This blue bar represents your current level of health. As you sustain regular damage, it will turn black. If your health is completely depleted, you suffer final death and your game is over. Your health regenerates over time. When you're feeding, your health regenerates much faster. If your health bar begins to turn yellow, it means you have sustained aggravated damage. Certain hazards like fire and supernatural attacks cause aggravated damage. This takes much longer to heal than regular damage. Anything back here? Nope.
Fucking waste of unlife, these Sabbat Vatos. You get winged? Hey, hey! Look at them potholes. Those will close up soon enough. Better feed, though. There's someone down the stairs here. It's not the freshest catch, but it'll do.
What's the difference? Blood's blood, right?
Well, when it comes to feeding, it's quality blood you're looking for, not the quantity. Bums and lowlife don't pack the same punch that a healthy, well-bred human will. Juice bags with a pedigree, that's the good stuff. But you gotta take what you can get. You ever had a PhD, kid? Ooh, that's good stuff.
Yeah, if you say so.
Remember what I said, though. Don't kill them. At least not the innocent ones. You're a monster now. Make no mistake. One of the damned and the fallen. You need to hold on to every last shred of humanity you have.
So, let's just say I get a little overzealous. What happens then?
An innocent's an innocent. You kill one. Even a worthless bum, even by accident, and it's gonna cost you a piece of your own humanity. Bring you closer to that beast you got welling up inside you.
The beast? What exactly does that mean?
The beast? It's always there. It's waiting to take over. When it does, it's like a wild animal wearing your skin. Desperate, scared, reckless. He'll do anything to survive, and it's you that has to deal with the consequences.
So I can't kill anyone? Seems a little, restricting.
I said innocent humans. If some asshole levels a 12-gauge your way, you drain him, skin him, and bash in his skull. Self-preservation is a vital part of humanity, after all. My favorite part, in fact.
I think I follow.
The only way to fight the beast is to keep in touch with your humanity, and don't go hungry. It's a fine line.
Got it.
All right, now go feed. Careful, though. He's gonna drain fast.
Be back in a minute. Remember, you want to avoid draining your victims. Draining innocent humans will give you a penalty to your humanity. The lower your humanity, the closer you get to the beast. If your humanity gets too low, you'll begin to lose control of your character. This is known as frenzying. It may result in a masquerade violation if you're around humans. You don't say. Ooh, he goes down fast. Alright, that's it.
Not quite as good, huh? Yeah, you can do worse. There's some rats down the way. You think I'm kidding? You can survive feeding on animals if you can stomach that kind of thing.
Worse than a bum's neck? That scarf tasted like old gym socks.
Well, give it a try.
I'll think about it. Rats can be fed upon to gain a single blood point. You will find some rats at the other end of the alley, near the yellow windows. Killing rats has no impact on your humanity score. Humans do not react well when they see live rats being sucked on. You know what? It doesn't hurt. How do I get them? Do I just punch them? Oh. I can't collect them. Not like in the first game. You have to feed on them while they're there.
You rat sucker! Hey, I don't care what you do, but just so you know, polite vampire society looks down on that kind of thing.
After chasing one of those, I don't blame him.
Keep it down. Got someone around the way here.
Just one guy?
Not too much of a threat by himself, but you never know if there's more in shouting range. You're gonna have to sneak past.
Sneak where?
The building across from us with the garage door. There's some double doors on the far side. I'll meet you inside. Just stay low and stick to the shadows. And don't let him see you.
I'll do my best. See you in a minute.
All right, go.
Gone. Sneaking, a combination of dex and stealth, is a feat that allows you to move among your victims and enemies without being detected. You must be crouched to sneak. You can crouch by pressing the crouch key. The meter to the left indicates the proximity of your enemies and their chances of detecting you if they're looking your way. Green means you're completely safe. Yellow means you might be seen, and red means they will see you if they look in your direction. An enemy's chance of detecting you is directly tied to your sneaking feat. If you are detected, your enemies will often say as much and come to investigate. Okay. Sure. And I'm going to call it there for this episode. It's actually gone on a bit longer than I would like, but I was kind of rambling a little bit during the character creation. I hope you guys are enjoying what you've seen so far. Trust me, once the game opens up, it's so much fun. The quests are so cool. The characters are even better. It's really something. Anyways, I will see you guys in the next one. Take care.